Hello, those at home, and welcome to The Clockwork, a podcast that takes a deeper dive into historic teams. My name is Ryan Branson, and I'll be your host today alongside Josh Michella and James Gaudreau.
How's it going?
What's up?
For listening to Clockwork, we're going to take a deep look at the 2008 Florida Gators, the best team in college football, winning the national championship with a storied coach in college. But if we took a deeper dive into the analytics and character of the team, it may be shocking. The 2008 Florida Gators season, 13-1 with big wins against ranked teams, star-studded with numerous five-star recruits. In a quote by Urban Meyer, Florida's roster had 19 players eventually selected in the NFL draft, including 6 first-round picks, 5 second-round picks, a third-round pick, 2 fourth-round picks, 4 fifth-round picks, and 1 seventh-round pick. Only 3 of those draft selections are no longer in the league as of today. This program was led by Coach Urban Meyer, who won 3 national championships. He's the current coach of the Jacksonville Jaguars. In 2018, he retired after being suspended 3 games for mishandling allegations of spousal abuse. Meyer walked away from the Gators after roster manipulation, a drug problem in the locker room, and more than 30 players arrested in 6 seasons.
It's really crazy to think that such a team led by Tim Tebow, who was a devout Christian, has such a history of all those players being arrested. It's just really weird.
I agree. Also, just the fact that there's so many people that made it into the NFL with that is crazy.
The starting quarterback who won the national championship was Tim Tebow. As Josh said, a heavily religious person. He was spreading Christianity through the locker room. He won 2 national championships. He was a Heisman winner, and he was a first-round pick, and no arrests to this day. The second quarterback was Cam Newton. He ended up being the first overall pick in 2011. He won the national championship twice, and he was arrested on felony charges of burglary, larceny, and obstruction of justice on an accusation that he stole a laptop computer from another University of Florida student. When the police came up to his room, he threw all the computers out of the window.
And, you know, Cam Newton obviously went on to have a pretty successful NFL career after transferring to Auburn, and, you know, he won another national title there, so it just goes to show that you can get away with that kind of stuff.
No, yeah, I agree. I don't see Cam Newton doing that kind of crime, I feel like.
Next up is the wide receivers and tight ends. Riley Cooper led them with 18 touchdowns through 4 years. He had 1,500 yards, and he was caught saying a racial slur at a Chesney concert. In 2009, he had a misdemeanor for resisting an officer and failure to comply with police, and he was arrested for punching a police officer in the face. The most infamous was Aaron Hernandez. He won the John Mackey Award, the national championship, and was one of the best and most electric players in the NFL for the New England Patriots, and went to 2 Super Bowls. He was arrested and charged for the murder of Odin Lloyd, and he was convicted for the shootings of 3 other people in 2 separate incidents dating back to his college days.
Obviously, he was the most infamous player of this team and probably one of the most popular ones. He had such a star-studded career up to the point where he got arrested, and it was just came as such a shock to the football world that something like this happened and just sent waves throughout college football and NFL football.
It's hard to believe that someone like that could do such a crime. There's actually a great documentary about it on Netflix.
Yeah, it was kind of crazy about how, like, an NFL player could do all of that, and then nobody really knew. And, for example, people believed him the whole time, and the main example is that is on the offensive line, the Pouncey brothers. Both were 5-star recruits. Both of them were national championships. Both of them were first-team All-SEC. And Michael Pouncey was a 2-time first-team All-American, and his brother was a 1-time first-team All-American. They ended up getting both arrested in a fight in a Miami strip club and ended up being a misdemeanor. But they were the ones that led the Free Hernandez movement, making hats and T-shirts and selling it to the other NFL players. They, to this day, believe he was innocent, and I don't know what that says about them, but they're very opinionated in their own minds.
I mean, obviously these guys getting charged with a misdemeanor for getting in a fight in a strip club is ridiculous in itself, but then on top of that, the fact that they're defending Aaron Hernandez, you know, by selling his merchandise, and maybe it was a get-rich-quick scheme, and, you know, maybe they don't truly believe that he was innocent, but, you know, it's just crazy to think that such a dysfunctional team could have so much success in such a difficult landscape like college football.
And then next up was the storied defensive line. This was one of the most disruptive defensive lines in the history of college football, which many people believed ended up helping them win the national championship as a key puzzle piece. And to start it off, Carlos Dunlap, national championship. He was the second-round pick for the Bengals, and he was arrested and charged with driving under the influence. And he was suspended for the SEC championship against Alabama for that incident. But he ended up returning the next game after that for the Sugar Bowl. But it was a little weird because this has happened a couple times where players got arrested right before a big game and either served one game or didn't serve any. And most of them were – actually, all of them were back for the national championship, which didn't really serve well under the coach of Urban Meyer.
I mean, there's just this common theme throughout college football of all these great players who just get into trouble. You know, most recently, one of the names that comes to mind is Baker Mayfield with his whole incident. You know, he still went on to be drafted with a number one overall pick by the Cleveland Browns and has gone on to have a, you know, decently successful NFL career.
Next up was Jermaine Cunningham. He was a second-round pick. They said he could have been a top 15 pick, except for he had a misdemeanor battery in 2007 when he ended up punching a underage kid, or also known as a minor. He was arrested for a hit and run also, and he still went on to be a national champion and a second-round pick and was not suspended for any of those games.
Yeah, I mean, that in itself is ridiculous. You know, if you're going to abuse a minor and, you know, basically get away with it, that's absurd. That's a flaw in the justice system, and, you know, it's bad on the Gators coaches for not taking action.
Yeah, to go off what Josh said, I think it looks bad for the whole organization for not suspending people like this, because clearly they've done something so incredibly wrong, and I feel like they need to be punished for it.
Next up is the linebackers. One of the best linebackers in college football that year, Brandon Spikes, first team All SEC, unanimous first team All American, and he was charged in a 2015 hit and run. He hit three people and drove off from it. It was a little bit disappointing to see nothing really came of it. It was towards the end of his NFL career, which it wasn't a long run. He was with the Eagles and the Patriots, so a little bit disappointing.
Yeah, I mean, I just remember watching this guy as a Patriot back in like 2010, and you know, to see that stuff like this can happen, and you know, it's so common throughout the NFL. It's just crazy.
I mean, I have to agree with you there. I mean, all these great players getting arrested for stuff and getting in trouble, and hardly anything even happens.
Next up is also the linebacker Dustin Doe. He was a very high draft pick. He was a national championship like all of these athletes, and he had a misdemeanor, a fray, and resisting arrest for his role in a 2007 fight during April, which was the spring of the season heading into this 2008 year, which was pretty disappointing for this team considering all of the arrests ended up kind of washing away and nothing really came of it. And this team was full of massive playmakers and one of the most electric teams in college football history, led by a quarterback who was a devout Christian and spread and deeply believed in Christianity. A team led by a Christian quarterback and a scandalous coach ended up being very talented, but also the team with the most arrests in college football history. It seems like many of the players got off with their charges because they played in Florida, the greatest and worst team ever in college football. Well,
stay.